From humble beginnings in a rural French-Canadian hometown, she has risen to international superstardom. She has been called the premier contemporary pop vocalist of the 90s. She has earned music industry accolades from around the globe, including the World Music Award, recognizing her as the best-selling female artist of all time. The world has seen her literally transform herself from a gifted pre-adolescent to an international superstar. Plus, it's her birthday. And that is why, tonight, I will be discussing Celine Dion. Celine Dion was born on March 30th, 1968, in Montreal, Quebec, Canada, but was raised in the small town of Charlemagne, about 50 kilometers away. She was the youngest of 14 children, them being Linda, Claudette, Daniel, Liette, Clément, Ghislaine, Denise, Manon, Louise, Jacques, Paul, Michel, and Pauline, to father Adhémar Charles Dion and mother Thérèse Tanguay Dion. Celine came from a musical family. Her parents, both musicians, operated a small club, and on weekends, the entire family would perform for the population. At age 5, Celine quickly acquired the ability to perform live. However, at the age of 12, everything changed. With the help of her mother and brother Jacques, Celine composed a song, Ce n'était qu'un rêve, that she sent to René Angélil, a very well-respected personal manager in Quebec. In 1981, René was so taken aback by the voice that he was determined to make her an international superstar. He even mortgaged his own home to finance her first album. It was at that moment that Celine dropped out of her elementary school, École Saint-Jude, and never looked back.
The teacher at the school said to my mom, she's always in the sky, thinking about something else, but not school. One day, they had a little meeting, Mom and Celine.
They said that she really liked to sing. Come on, she has a chance. She should make a career out of it.
They decide to take Celine off the school and have a private teacher.
La rupture de l'école.
Leaving school was my parents' decision. Celine was very spoiled, and she always got what she wanted.
Her first album, La Voix du Bon Dieu, all of which written by famous French songwriter Eddie Marnay, was a huge success in Quebec, prompting Celine to make many appearances in malls and TV shows. Michel Jasmin, the Quebec equivalent of Jay Leno, invited her on her show.
With 2.5 million people watching every night, the show has a very big impact. I introduced her, and René, just before she walked in, apparently, he told her, you go, you can do it, you're the best in the world.
Céline Dion.
Le soleil est Céline Dion.
She sang beautifully, but she was very, very shy for her first TV appearance, so she was nervous.
1982, Celine traveled to Japan as France's contestant for the Yamaha World Song Festival.
Celine Dion!
She gets in a stage, there's 60,000 people, and she just walks in and it's just so natural. We were looking at her like saying, you go girl, you can do it, you're good.
最優秀賞の発表です。Best
Song Award. She wins the contest.
Go France! ママに贈る歌!
Entry number 5, France.
And the Canadian entry that year was a young performer making his first appearance there as well, called Brian Adams. Brian lost to Celine, and I can remember talking to his manager. They were furious, and they had never heard of this Celine Dion.
2 years later, on September 11th, 1984, Celine was chosen to perform for Pope John Paul II in Montreal's Olympic Stadium. Then, Celine had a major makeover. She took a year and a half off to completely revolutionize herself because she was not the best looking teen. She was often called Dracula because of her buck and sharp teeth. And because she was a very sensitive person, this greatly affected her.
Big ruffled blouses and like the big hair and all that.
She was a very, very gawky teenager in those days.
She looked 13 and not very beautiful, as a matter of fact.
Celine returned after her hiatus and headed for America. Watching the 1985 American Music Awards, Celine was inspired by Michael Jackson and wanted to get a recording contract with the same label as him. So, Renee gave her an ultimatum. If she could go back to school and learn English, Renee would get her a deal with the same record label as MJ. Celine completed her one-year English program in less than 3 months. And so, Incognito was subsequently produced by CBS Records, Michael Jackson's label. The album was released on Thursday, April 2nd, 1987, and it was a really big deal because Celine was a brand new woman and no longer Quebec's little girl. However, with positive reviews came some backlash. At the 1990 Association Québécoise de l'Industrie du Disque, du Spectacle et de la Vidéo, the organization that honors excellence in the Quebec music industry, Celine was awarded Anglophone Artist of the Year. At the show, which was broadcast live across Canada, Dion refused the award, and here's why.
Je peux pas accepter ce trophée-là. C'est pas parce que je suis pas fière de mon disque en anglais, au contraire. Je suis très fière de mon disque. Et je tiens à remercier toute l'équipe de CBS qui m'encourage puis qui me supporte partout à travers le monde en tant qu'une chanteuse québécoise. Et je tiens à remercier le public aussi. Parce que je pense qu'eux autres ont compris que j'étais pas une artiste anglophone. Partout dans le monde, je dis que je suis fière d'être québécoise. Et j'aimerais faire une petite suggestion aux gens de la disque. Moi aussi. Si je peux me permettre. Au lieu d'appeler ça le trophée, c'est-à-dire la nomination pour l'artiste anglophone de l'année, pourquoi on n'appellerait pas ça l'artiste québécois s'étant le plus illustré sur un plan international? Je pense que ce serait une réflexion beaucoup plus juste du travail que certains artistes ici, que font les artistes québécois ici. Merci.
3 years later, in 1988, Celine competed for Switzerland at the Eurovision Song Contest in Dublin, Ireland. In a stunning turn of events, Celine beat the UK by 1 point with her song Ne Partez Pas Sans Moi, thanks to Yugoslavia.
Good evening, Yugoslavia. Good evening, Ljubljana.
Good evening, Dublin. Ljubljana calling. Here are the results of the Yugoslav jury. Israel, 1 point. Ireland, 2 points. Luxembourg, 3 points. Spain, 4 points. Italy, 5 points. Switzerland, 6 points.
Oh. Switzerland, 6 points.
Well, it puts Switzerland 1 point in the lead, so it depends.
Switzerland, 7 points.
Together.
Germany, 8 points. Norway, 10 points.
10 points to Norway. Who's getting the 12?
10 points.
And finally, France. Oh.
Oh, goodness.
Finally.
What? Kicked at the post by Yugoslavia. Well, no, by Switzerland. They've won by 1 point. We didn't hear. I didn't catch who that last 12 points went to. You think it's France. France took the 12 points and just picked the United Kingdom of the closest finish I've ever seen at the Eurovision Song Contest. Hit them by 1 point. There's the winner, Switzerland's Celine Dion.
And it was that fateful day that started Celine and Renee's truly remarkable love story.
I knew I was going to marry him and make love to him the first time, and I knew that was it.
They were reluctant to tell Celine's mother about their relationship, but knew they couldn't hide their affair for long.
I realized they were having an affair, but it took a while for him to confess. So I confronted him about the situation and tried to, how should I say, set him straight.
Oh yeah, yeah, you can believe that. She had a heavy talk with me, her mother.
Eventually, they won the blessing of Celine's mother. However, Celine had just turned 20, Renee was 46, and the new couple wasn't so sure the public would be so accepting. So they decided to keep their love affair a secret from the world. Then, in May of 93, Celine received an urgent call. Her young niece, Corinne, was losing her battle with cystic fibrosis. Moments later, Corinne passed away. She was just 16 years old. The passing of her niece reminded Celine just how fleeting life can be. And now she was no longer willing to hide the one thing that meant the most to her, her love for her manager, Renee Angelil. But Renee still feared that Celine's fans would reject her for loving a man more than twice her age.
For a few years, we didn't tell anyone, and that was my idea. She wanted to tell everyone, but I was afraid that the fans wouldn't accept that.
Renee's fears were unfounded. In fact, once their relationship was made public, fans embraced the couple. In the winter of 94, 6 years after their first kiss, Celine and Renee were married. Held in Montreal's Notre Dame Cathedral, the grand ceremony resembled a royal wedding. All of Canada watched as the couple exchanged vows on national television.
Oui, je le veux.
It was like for 500 people, and the whole country was a witness of this wedding. It was a big affair, a beautiful church, a great day, a beautiful ceremony after, and a day we'll never forget.
Now, to the highlight of Celine's career, My Heart Will Go On. Did you know that Celine originally did not want to record the track? It's true. Titanic composer James Horner did not want another orchestral cue at the end of the film, so he wrote the song and presented it to Celine and Renee.
I started to sing the song, and everybody started to cry in the studio.
When every hair on your body stands up, it's like you know you've got something here. Well, by the end of that session, we were all literally like this. We had such chills.
Near, far, wherever you are, I believe that the heart does go on.
It was during this tour on a flight to Dallas that Renee discovered a lump on his neck. Upon landing, he got it checked out. It was cancer. Celine ended up completing the tour on her own while Renee rested comfortably at home. But Celine was eager to take a much-needed hiatus to start a family and now care for Renee. Once the tour was over, Celine gave one last performance on New Year's Eve in Montreal as a farewell-type concert before taking her three-year hiatus. During said hiatus, two magical things happened. Renee's cancer was in remission within 6 months, and Celine's lifelong dream of becoming a mother came true. On January 25, 2001, Renee Charles was born in West Palm Beach, Florida. Now that her life was complete, Celine and her family decided to celebrate by taking a trip to Vegas. There, Celine saw Cirque du Soleil's O and told Renee that she wanted a show just like that. So, with Renee's power and connections, he signed a three-year residency deal in March of 2003, the first of its kind, to build a 4,000-seat theater at Caesar's Palace, where Celine would perform five nights a week. The residency was such a success that it was later extended to five. Unfortunately, tragedy struck again.
Tonight is a very special night for me. It is also a very difficult day. I've lost my dad this morning. I insisted of coming. and I will give everything I have. And I would like to dedicate this show to him.
When her contract was up, Celine embarked on her biggest world tour yet, the Taking Chances World Tour, to promote the release of her new album of the same name. Celine performed 133 sold-out shows on 5 continents in 25 countries in 93 cities, and cameras covered the entire tour from every angle. The film was then released to theaters for a limited time to allow the public to see what life is like on the road.
The concert, a new live DVD CD.
What do you say?
Share the journey with Celine Dion.
Once the tour was over, Celine took another hiatus, this time for a year and a half, to grow her family once more. It took her 6 in vitro fertilizations to become pregnant again, and on Saturday, October 23rd, 2010, Celine gave birth to healthy fraternal twins. The twins were named Eddie, after Celine's favorite songwriter Eddie Marnay, and Nelson, after South African President Nelson Mandela. However, even before Celine was pregnant with the twins, she signed another residency deal with Caesar's Palace, this time an 8-year deal, spanning from 2011 to 2019.
So there have been rumors that you're going back to Vegas, is that true? Are you going to go back?
It's not a rumor, I'm going back to Las Vegas. Oh.
You're going back to Vegas!
In 2013, 2 years after the start of her second residency, tragedy struck again. The cancer had come back to Renee, and the following year, Celine took a 1-year hiatus to care for her husband. I was lucky enough to see her last show on July 29, 2014, before that 1-year break. Celine did return to the stage in August of 2015, but less than 6 months later, on January 14, 2016, 2 days before his 74th birthday, Renee Angelil passed away of terminal throat cancer. 2 days later, on his birthday, Celine Dion's brother Daniel passed away of terminal throat cancer as well. Evidently, Celine Dion had to suspend her show until further notice. A public service was held for Renee on January 21st, 2016, at Montreal's Notre Dame Basilica, the same place that Celine and Renee were married just 20 years ago. The funeral was broadcast live on television and the internet for the world to see.
15 years is not a long time for a son to get to know his father.
3 days later, a funeral was held for Celine's brother Daniel that she and her children did not attend due to the overwhelming grief they were suffering. On February 3rd, 2016, a memorial was held at Caesar's Palace for Renee that was also live-streamed over the internet. 2 weeks later, Celine made the difficult decision to come back to the stage. A portion of her first show back was dedicated to Renee, and that portion was also live-streamed over the internet on her website. This inevitably skyrocketed ticket demands, with celebrities including Selena Gomez attending her show. To date, Celine has produced 25 studio albums, 16 of which in French and the other 9 in English. She's been on numerous tours, with one planned for this very summer following the release of a new French album. She'll be performing shows in Belgium, France, and Canada, one of which I will be attending. Celine has won numerous awards, including 5 Grammys and 2 Oscars. She's been given a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame on January 6, 2004, and made a Companion of the Order of Canada on July 26, 2013. Now that we've finished Celine Dion's biography, let's talk about the business side of things. Celine Dion has endorsed many companies, including Chrysler, Vogue, Cystic Fibrosis Canada, and the Celine Dion Foundation. Celine's deal with Chrysler was said to have failed, as it marketed her more than it did the car. But between you and me, is that so bad? It's Chrysler. Celine's team, headed by Renee, has also been very good at promoting her albums, concerts, and products. She's been on numerous TV shows, including The Ellen Show, Larry King, and Oprah, while also using billboards, TV, and the internet to promote herself. And if that wasn't enough, Celine Dion has her very own store in Caesar's Palace, simply named the Celine Dion Boutique, where you can buy any and all Celine Dion-related products. Not only that, but she owns two restaurants. The first is the Nichols chain, started in 1990, named after Celine's Lucky Charm, a 1968 Canadian nickel that she found in Japan before she went on stage to sing at the Yamaha Song Contest. The other, with which she has part ownership, is Montreal's hallmark deli, Schwartz's, which was bought in 2012. As far as competition goes, Celine is incomparable to other artists like Jennifer Lopez and Britney Spears, who also have Vegas residencies, because she was the first to do so, she's been nicknamed the Queen of Vegas, and she's the reason that Vegas has become way more family-friendly. Celine doesn't really have a target market, as throughout the years, she's changed styles, genres, and age groups. Her team uses a mass marketing type scheme because she's sung songs from famous French composers, as well as current artists like Sia and Ne-Yo. Celine Dion is the hardest working celebrity of our generation. For over 30 years, she has constantly been working, even through the most heartbreaking of times. The most important part about her, however, has to be that she prioritizes motherhood, family, and love above her career. On March 12, 2007, she told People magazine, "My life is to be a mom. It is what I enjoy the most. It is my most amazing reward. I will take a chance with my music. I don't take risks with my family." And that is why I believe she's so popular. No matter that her net worth of about $650 million surpasses Elvis Presley, Lady Gaga, and Adele combined, she is still the most sincere, genuine, and down-to-earth celebrity I have ever known. To end the show, I'd just like to wish Celine a very happy birthday as she turns 48 today. Unfortunately, it'll be the first birthday that she spends without her husband Rene Angelil. Regardless, all the best to you, Celine. And that's it for this episode of The Rabin Report. My name is Elliot Rabin. We'll see you next week.